no shark science here, but it's been what, like 6 hours and she's already resorting to eating crabs. Hello everyone and welcome back to another episode of Shark Bytes, the best place online for you to get your shark fix. That's right, we're back again with what I can safely say is probably everyone's favourite part of the channel, shark movie commentaries. But before today's video, make sure you check out our last movie commentary here, where we dived into Deep Blue Sea. I mean, it's purely worth watching for that Sam Jackson death scene alone. And again, if you like these movie commentaries here on Shark Bytes, make sure you hit that subscribe button below to keep seeing more of them. I had a bunch of you suggesting what movie you wanted to see in the comments section of the last video, and it was a tough call between The Shallows and Shark Tale. I've decided to go with The Shallows in the end, but if you want to see a movie commentary on Shark Tale, make sure you spam that in the comments below. Today's film, however, was released back in 2016 and grossed over $119 million worldwide. It stars teen heartthrob Blake Lively in probably her biggest film to date as she battles a great white shark about 200 yards from the shore. Now, this is your final warning. As always, this episode does contain blood and gore and has spoilers for the film. So if you haven't seen it, well, you know the drill. So grab yourselves your favourite beverage, sit back, relax, and enjoy this movie commentary of The Shallows with a real-life shark scientist. Okay, so I've pretty much been able to skip the first 20 minutes of the film here, which is just an assortment of various clips of Blake Lively in a bikini and close-up shots of her body double surfing. Honestly, I think I'd have had to stick a PG warning on this episode if I'd have included those. Some suspenseful shots here, though, of Blake out alone in the water, which you definitely shouldn't be doing if you don't want to drown and die. There's no way you'd catch me out alone on a beach I'd never been to before, but each to their own. We get fooled here at thinking this is a shark, but it's actually a dolphin. Sneaky directors. I know your game. Interesting fact though, even though dolphins are around, that doesn't mean that sharks aren't around. People often get a false sense of security when they see dolphins and they think that means there's no sharks in the water, but there are so many clips online of white sharks cruising in real close proximity to pods of dolphins. Okay, we could be in trouble now. We've got a whale carcass. I'm not quite sure how she hasn't seen the whale before now, but this is 100% time to get the hell out of there. I mentioned in a few of the Shark Bytes episodes and a couple of movie commentaries that whale carcasses act as dinner bells to all kinds of sharks. So if you're seeing one of these, it's time to leave. I love how she gets thwarted by a seagull there and just falls off her board for some reason. What? So Blake decides she's off, and we probably get one of my favourite shots from the film here of the shark just cruising through this wave. Awesome. The shark decides it's going to yeet her off the board in the middle of the wave here. To be fair, this does actually happen on occasion in real life. Check out this guy who gets knocked off his board by a spinner shark in Australia. Significantly less graceful than Blake Lively's shark, that's for sure. Anyway, as she's trying to get back on the board, Blake, as expected, gets bitten. Which is kind of accurate, I'd say. That initial pull down, and then the shark lets her go. So for a normal prey item, this is where the shark would let the prey bleed out, and then it would come back after a little while to feed on it. They're kind of lazy like that. One thing I'm not quite sure on here, though, is why the shark is actively choosing to go for Blake when there's a massive, highly nutritious meal literally 15 yards away in the form of that whale carcass. She finds herself now on top of the whale carcass and decides she's going to strap the wound. It's a good job her character is a trainee doctor, because this is exactly what you should be trying to do to stop that bleeding. Otherwise, you're going to die pretty quickly. Realizing that she doesn't really want to play a game of tug of war with a whale carcass and a great white shark, Blake decides she's going to make a swim for it. Okay, so this isn't how sharks behave around whale carcasses at all. Sharks tend to gorge themselves really slowly on these carcasses until they literally can't eat anymore. People often get confused and think great white sharks are pregnant, like in this picture here, but that is literally just a shark that has eaten so much of a whale carcass that it's about to explode. No shark science here, but it's been what, like 6 hours and she's already resorting to eating crabs. I mean, yeah, if she's been there for a couple of days, it's probably time to start eating crabs. We also get introduced here to Blake's injured co-star, Steven Seagal, who I find myself rooting for far more than Blake throughout the film. We also get Seagal eating crabby throw-up. Gross. A couple of locals are on their way out now to try and rescue stranded Blake as she tries to warn them about their impending doom. Oh! One of them gets completely slaughtered by the shark. Wow. So, as dramatic as that was, and don't get me wrong, I love the drama, generally that's not how shark attacks on surfers tend to go. More often than not, it's a bit of a splashy scrap at the surface as the shark sort of rolls around. Sharks aren't going to be full-blown breaching, like in this example, because we're not seals. Seals are a very fast-moving prey item who are super agile in the water, and that's why sharks have to hit them at pace from below. And even then, sometimes the seals still get away. We, on the other hand, are pretty slow-moving in comparison to a seal. So a shark isn't going to be expending all that energy to attack a slow-moving prey item like us with a full breach. It's pretty much just going to cruise up and hit us with a bit of a roll. And that's what we see most often when shark attacks on surfers have been caught on film. I think I should make it clear here again that we as humans are definitely not prey items for shark species. But for the purpose of analysing the shark science behind this film, those are my thoughts. So Blake here desperately trying to grab the helmet and GoPro from the guy who's just been eaten so she can record some kind of heartfelt last message to her family. But the shark is not going to let her do that and launches itself onto the rocks to stop her. We get a pretty good shot here though of the nictitating membrane rolling over that eye, which is that protective layer that I've mentioned to you before, which rolls over to keep their eyes safe during predation events. Although it looks like the membrane has rolled over because the shark has been stung by that fire coral, and that's the bit I'm not really convinced by. Fire corals can be pretty painful for humans, as the nematocysts on the coral have a really, really powerful sting. It's basically a primary defense mechanism for the coral against any parrotfish that might fancy a nibble. But against a shark, I'm not so sure. Shark skin is almost like armor plating for a shark, and we've mentioned before how it's made up of thousands of tiny, tiny placoid scales, which not only helps it swim more efficiently, but it also acts as a defense mechanism for the shark. The whale shark, for example, has some of the thickest skin in the animal kingdom, and it's thought to be about 6 inches thick. That's pretty much the size of a standard calculator, and almost the size of my tiny head. Steven Seagal here has been placed on a piece of surfboard debris to try and save him from the impending tide, and please, for the love of God, don't let him be smashed by this shark. Honestly, I'm seriously rooting for him more than the main protagonist in this film. Why are the directors doing this to us? It's actually killing me. The seagull survives. In a bid to get away from the shark here, Blake swims directly into a giant smack of jellyfish, which is, of course, the collective noun for jellyfish, and also what I've wanted to do to my face for the majority of this film so far. After she gets a nasty sting on the arm and lets out an underwater yelp, the jellyfish decide they're going to bioluminesce and start glowing for some reason. The shark here though trying to plow through those jellies but getting hurt in the process, and again for the reasons we mentioned earlier with the fire coral, I really don't think jellyfish stings are strong enough to do enough damage to that shark skin. At least to deter it like that anyway. If that shark really wanted to get to Blake, I'm pretty sure it could have there. Having made her way to this buoy and finding a flare gun, Blake drops her first F-bomb of the film, which I'd have done at least 12 hours prior to this point. Anyway, she shoots the shark and creates a flaming inferno from the whale carcass. So I'm pretty sure that's not how whale oil works. I think you have to process that stuff before it becomes flammable, like normal oil. But I guess the directors wanted to put in a cool flaming shark jump, you know. As you do. This has clearly annoyed the shark even more as it leaps out of the water and starts chowing down on the metal of the buoy here. It has really kicked off in the last few minutes of this film. So sharks can't cleanly bite through metal like this. They've got a pretty powerful bite force, yes, but not strong enough to do this. There's loads of clips online of white sharks chowing down on dive cages and not breaking them. I suppose you could say this metal is rusted and a little bit old, maybe. I'm not convinced. Heading to the climax of the film here, and after some more consumption of metal by the shark, Blake decides she's going to use a heavy section of the buoy to plummet down to the bottom of the sea to get away. I mean, I'm pretty impressed that she's managed to figure out this plan for killing the shark, having been utterly terrorized by the shark for the best part of, what, 15 hours, working purely off a diet of crabs. Fair play, Blake. Fair play. And bang! The shark skewers itself on some spiky metal, even though we've literally seen 2 minutes ago that the shark is very adept at biting through metal. But alas, the shark becomes a shark kebab, and Blake wins the day. Are we ever going to get a shark film where the shark wins? Confirmation here for you all that Best Supporting Actor Steven Seagal survived his voyage back to dry land. I know you were all as desperate as I was to confirm that, so there you go. A year later now, and Blake, having recovered from her ordeal, getting her doctor qualifications, and reconciling with her dad, decides it's time to get back in the water. You know what they say about getting back on the horse? What a happy ending. And there we go, folks. That was The Shallows. Now, it's a tricky one for me because I did enjoy the film, but it really takes a while to get going. I just found myself wanting to see more action stuff with the shark, but for the majority of the film, it's just Blake Lively sitting on a rock. I might be being a little harsh here, I don't know. The last 15 minutes of the film is action-packed for sure though, and was pretty enjoyable. Now, in terms of the shark science behind the film. To be fair, it's probably one of the most realistic CGI sharks I've seen in all shark films. Okay, maybe it's a little bit on the large size, but still pretty accurate. And we even get a fully functioning nictitating membrane. But the concept of a shark that's got a giant nutritious meal in the form of a whale carcass but decides to go for a few bony humans, I can't really buy into. So I think for realism, I was pretty impressed by that CGI shark, so I'm going to give it 6 out of 10. Then for overall entertainment, unfortunately for me, the film just took so long to get going. And yeah, okay, the last 15 minutes was pretty epic, but the majority of the film, pretty slow. So for me, it's got to be a 4 out of 10. So what do you think of my ratings? A little bit harsh maybe? What would you give The Shallows out of 10? I want to hear all of your thoughts in the comments below. Also, keep letting me know all of your suggestions for shark films that you want to see movie commentaries on. If I see a particular film is cropping up loads in the comments, I'm 100% going to do it. So let me know. And as always, if you enjoyed this video, please do give it a like. And don't forget to subscribe to the Shark Bytes channel below, where you can stay up to date with all of our latest videos. Until then, see you next time.